adventure begins along the central coast of the great state of California. Here, the Santa Lucia Mountains rise from the Pacific Ocean in a region named Big Sur. This pristine and undeveloped coastline has been described as one of the most stunning meeting points of land and sea on the planet. Circling high above is the mighty California condor. Today, the presence of wild California condors above the cliffs of this coastal state is a miracle of modern conservation.
Look at that. Is that adult or subadult?
Well, because we can see the white wing patch under the wing, that would be an adult condor that we see right now.
So that's at least 5 or 6 years old.
At least, yeah.
Incredible. My friends, this is Pam Flick. She is, of course, with Defenders of Wildlife. And what makes the story of the California condor so remarkable?
Well, Jeff, I think it's a special story because it's one of hope and one that demonstrates that it truly takes a village to save a species from extinction.
This is North America's largest flying bird. It's got nearly a 10-foot wingspan. It's weighing 20 pounds plus in size. It takes a lot to keep these birds alive, doesn't it?
It does. They can range over 200 miles in a single day on foraging missions. They need a lot of habitat.
So today, we can come along this coast and have this spectacular moment. But this was a species that was in true jeopardy, wasn't it?
Absolutely. In 1982, the entire population of California condors was just 22 individuals. At the time, the decision was made to pull all the condors from the wild to start a captive breeding program.
But they're a complex creature. It takes years and years for an adult to get to that point where it can replace itself.
Yeah, at least 6 years. And that's one of the problems because they have such a slow population growth. And they only breed once every 2 to 3 years, and they only lay one egg per breeding attempt.
So Pam, how many condors do we have today?
Well, the entire population in the world is roughly 500, and of that, about 300 are free flying today. Here in the central coast of California, in the mountains of Southern California, in Baja, Mexico, Arizona, and Utah, and there's plans to reintroduce condors to the Yurok ancestral lands in northwestern California within the next year.
That's amazing.
Condors have been pulled from the brink of extinction, but the work has just begun. From the famous Pacific Coast Highway 1, we're traveling to a protected mountain peak high above the clouds.
Well, friends, get ready. You're about to experience one of my most favorite conservation projects in North America. We are working with the Ventana Wildlife Society. Their mission is to save what I consider the ambassador of the California sky.
The Ventana Wildlife Society currently monitors more than 100 condors and 10 active breeding pairs. Today, senior biologist Joe Burnett and his team are preparing the next generation of condors for their new lives in the wild.
Joe, so what is our mission today?
Today, we're gonna get these tags on the birds. So this is how we'll visually identify each individual out in the field with this color number combination. But our first step, we gotta get them in the nets and catch them.
All right.
Let's go do it.
Let's do it. This is gonna be fun.
We enter an area called the flight cage.
Get him.
There are 9 juvenile condors in this enclosure, and all of them are the product of active breeding programs.
What we're trying to do is carefully corral the condor. We don't want to stress it out.
But we can only work with one at a time.
Look at the size of this bird. I mean, it's just amazing. This is a very young bird. Right now, it has probably an 8-foot wingspan. Just incredible.
For this team, the safety of each condor is the highest priority.
I got a good grip.
All right, I'm just gonna slide my hand off.
Okay.
Perfect.
Oh my goodness, look at this. So this is a California condor. What I'm trying to do is just keep this bird stable and secure. We don't want the wings flapping around. It's very intense. It's intense for us. It's clearly intense for the condors. But just keeping the beak secure. You can see right there by my finger, those are the nares. I don't want to block that. I want to make sure this creature has a constant flow of air so it can breathe, it can cool down.
Today, we're replacing the bird's temporary tags with two permanent tags.
For condors, we put their tags on their wings on this piece of skin here. It's called the patagium. Similar to your earlobe, you can pierce through it. It's pretty painless.
This tag is solar powered, correct?
Yeah, solar powered. Yeah, and this should last, we're hoping, at least 5 years. This will tell us if he begins nesting. This tag will show us where the nest is.
Then we also have this visual ID. So clearly this orange tag will allow someone with a pair of binocs to say, okay, that's number 36. But it's not just 36, it's 1036. This is the 1,036th condor produced in this remarkable partnership. Still though, in the wild, they face so many challenges today, don't they, Joe?
Yeah, the threat of lead poisoning is our biggest obstacle right now.
This is an X-ray of a deer carcass. This deer was dispatched with lead ammunition, and these little fragments from that ammunition have contaminated the meat. If a condor were to eat even a tiny flake of lead, it could become very sick or even die.
Lead poisoning is the single biggest obstacle. You know, I've been working on this project long enough to know that if we get past lead poisoning, we're home free.
How do we fix this? We remove lead from the environment. We need to provide people with alternatives.
Yes. It's just working closely with hunters and ranchers, you know, the folks that might still be using lead ammunition, and showing them the data, showing them how it impacts condors and other wildlife.
The great news today, number 1036, this bird's going back in the wild.
Yeah,